heals my broken heart. Keep bringing me back to you again. Sometimes I fall apart, but you're always there, just like a friend, just like a friend.
Gather here in the presence of God to join this man and this woman in holy matrimony. Let us worship the Lord and make vows in the presence of God. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and I.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for a beautiful day you've given us to witness and to celebrate this holy matrimony of union of Johnny and Sydney. We thank you for bringing all of us here. We thank you for friends and family that have gathered. And we pray as we worship you, as we watch and we celebrate this moment, that you alone will be glorified and this wedding, this moment will be honoring to you. Be with this moment, be with this couple. Be with all of us. We thank you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
All right, let us sing. On the back of your bulletin, there should be lyrics for Come Thou Fount. And you can sing along with me.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never cease. For songs of loudest praise, teach me some melodious song, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon.
This is a reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 2. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the livestock and to the birds of the heavens, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was no a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon him. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from man, he made into woman and brought to the man. The man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked, and they were not ashamed." This is the word of the Lord.
Second reading is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 to 33. "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any blemish, holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body. But they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband."
Amen. Amen. Thank you for reading of God's word. Friends and family, marriage is a beautiful thing, isn't it? We're gathered here with all the ceremony, the clothes, the food, the party we're going to have. Marriage provides companionship. And as my wife once called it, you have a forever roommate now that you will live with for the rest of your life. Johnny, that means you no longer have to find a friend who will eat late night munches with you. She'll be there with you. As Sydney, now you could have a lifelong friend that will watch movies with you every night. And many have gathered here, drove, we flew, and travel long distances, especially in light of COVID-19, to get here to celebrate this time. And I'm sure that throughout this week and weeks to come, we're going to talk about how not only to make tonight special, for the rest of your life special. And for a brief moment, as we continue to share that, we want to follow the wise words of one of my favorite poets who once said, if you like it, then you put a ring on it. A young poet named Beyoncé. Before we follow her wise words, we're actually going to lean into someone who's wiser. The God of the universe has to say about what marriage ought to look like. And according to the verse that we read, gives us three building blocks of a marriage according to the scripture. So real quickly, guys. First building block that we see is that it takes not one, but two. Not one, but two. One of the most beloved pet birds is lovebirds. And these birds must come in pairs. They have to. Because not only do they mate for life, they feed with one another, even pine for one another. Meaning when one of them is missing, the other bird goes into depression. So in order to get this bird, you always have to get them in pairs. In Genesis chapter 2, we see that when Adam was created, that God said it was not good for Adam to be alone. We often mistaken this text by saying that Adam is only half good without the wife, therefore he needs the other half. Or as the movies will say, you complete me. But that's actually not what God is saying here. Because earlier on, when God creates Adam, God says it is good that he was created. So what does that mean? That it is not good for Adam to be alone? That means that Adam is made in the image of God and is good in his own right, but something is missing in picturing what God wants you to do, especially what God wants both of them to do. So what does God do next? What God does is he creates Eve out of Adam to create helper. And again, helper here is not saying he needs help or she's only made to help him. Helper here means that both of them together, not one, but two, like the lovebirds, must be together in picturing what God wants this marriage to do. And that's our prayer as we gather to celebrate this moment. And all our prayer for both of you is to strive to serve God's purposes together. Not one, not one's desire or the other, but both of them together at the same time. That's the first point. Second point, I'm going to confuse you a little bit. But second point is, not two, but one. Remember that? Not one, but two. But now, not two, but one. But second building block really is talking about what we're doing today, isn't it? Marriage is a union between two whole persons, but the goal is to be one. So that when Genesis chapter 2, when Adam first sees Eve, and I just found out that this moment as Sydney was walking down was the first time that Johnny saw you, and I could see the tears in his eyes. And actually, we see first look moment for Adam in Genesis chapter 2. And guess what he says to Eve? You're anticipating the most beautiful, most romantic thing ever. But this is what Adam says. You are bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. And a lot of you are thinking, all right, did he at least cry at this moment like Johnny did? That is not most romantic at all. Like, how many of you will go home and tell your wives, you're bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh, unless you want to sleep on the couch? But here lies the fundamental nature of the marriage. You know, the language that Adam is actually using is a deep covenantal bond. What he's saying here is, I'm going to be committed to you for the rest of my life. So when he says in verse 24, hold fast to his wife, to become one flesh, it's talking about relationship of covenant, commitment, sacrifice, giving yourself up for the other person so that you can form this marriage union together. That's what marriage is all about. Therefore, in marriage context, you should never use the D word ever. Sydney, you could say, I want to destroy you. I want to do all that, but not the other D word. You know what I'm talking about. not the word of separation or divorce, because God is binding you two to be one. And just quickly, before we go to the final point, I know you guys are thinking it's getting long. I want to bless you. I want to bless you by saying, may this be the worst day of your marriage. And you're thinking, what? This is my marriage day. But what I'm telling you guys is, this may be the worst day because from now on, for the rest of your life, it should get better and better and better. So it's a word of blessing, that this be the building blocks of the rest of your life. But the final building block of this marriage is not one, but two, not two, but one. But this one marriage union must be grounded upon the ultimate one, that is Christ Jesus our Lord. Why? Because as we know, marriage has lots of enemies, so many enemies. These enemies can be in the form of many things. We simply call them sin as well. It could be sin of selfishness of one another. It could be over-desire, idols, you name it. We know it. But that's not how it was meant to be. Verse 24 says, therefore man shall leave his father and his mother, hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Beautiful picture, but in chapter 3, right after this, sin enters, and what it does is it separates the bond between husband and wife. So what does God do in response to that? Is it simply do better in order to get this marriage going? Is it love more, sacrifice more? Absolutely not. What God does right after sin enters is the promise of a Savior. Because as much as you two love each other, I know you do. I know you are going to be sacrificial to one another. But unless Christ enters in this relationship and you're redeemed by his grace, the marriage union is only held together by your efforts. That's why in Genesis chapter 3:15, after God, sin enters, God promises a Savior, Christ, who will come to save mankind, so that this marriage, if it's founded upon foundation of Christ and the power of Christ, then this marriage can picture the Christ and the church and to serve God again. That's why this marriage union in Genesis is recoded in Ephesians chapter 5, talking about Christ's love for the church. That's our prayer, that your marriage will picture the body of Christ as well as Christ's sacrificial love for you. Friends and family, I had a privilege of getting to know Johnny and Sydney. It's just been a joy as I saw them walk through this process for the past couple months, especially in light of all the changes. And they're two distinct individuals. Yeah, I think a lot of us will tell you that too. They're very different, grew up in different household, different background, different personality, differences in many ways. Two distinct people coming together as one. But what I also found is their love for one another, their desire to be one, is one. Johnny desperately wants to marry Sydney. Sydney desperately, I believe, wants to marry Johnny as well. And they want to be together, picturing this body in Christ. That's why they're here. But what I have been most blessed by for this young couple is that both of them wanted to picture Christ and the church. In their testimony of how they came together and what they want to do for the rest of their life, already they want to ground themselves in Christ. And for that, not only am I a witness of your marriage today, but I'm blessed to be part of what God is going to do. As Sydney and Johnny sacrifice and give in loving for one another, as Sydney and Johnny live for one another, the Bible tells us, in fact, Christ died on the cross so you and I could live for him. May we place our faith in him and picture this truth. And I pray that this will be the foundation block for your marriage. Not one, but two. Not two, but one. But one, ultimately founded, planted in the foundation that is Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's pray, shall we? Father, we thank you so much for your grace that allow us to have this moment together, that out of your love for this couple, that we have gathered to witness a beautiful ceremony. We thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins, so that, Lord, now we are empowered to fight against sin that often entangles us. And we pray for this couple, Lord, that as they face many challenges of their lives, in fact, we do pray and bless them that this will be the worst day of their marriage, because from now on, for the rest of their lives, every day will be better and better and better, because they're being sanctified and they're growing to picture Christ more. And through that love, may their family and friends and many around them know Christ. And we thank you for this young couple's heart that is rooted in that. And Lord, may you alone be glorified and honored as we celebrate this union together. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Johnny, you could look at yourselves, and we're going to do a marriage vows. And here is the marriage vows that you have selected. I'm going to do my best so that Johnny could be heard.
All right. Sydney, I love you. I want to be your husband so that we might serve Christ together through all of the uncertainties and trials of life. I promise to be faithful to you and love you so that together we may grow in the likeness of Christ, that our home may be a praise to him.
Johnny, I love you. I want to be your wife so that we might serve Christ together. Through all of the uncertainties and trials of life, I promise to be faithful to you and love you, so that together we may grow in the likeness of Christ and that our home may be a praise to him.
We're going to do exchange of rings. Friends and family, the ring is round to indicate that as they begin this love, there's no end in this marriage. So this is a commitment they're making to one another in a covenant bond. You ready?
Yeah.
All right. Johnny, repeat after me. I, Johnny.
I, Johnny.
Okay,
yeah. Sorry.
Take you, Sydney.
Take you, Sydney.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
And I do promise.
And I do promise.
And covenant before God.
In a covenant before God.
And these witnesses.
And these witnesses.
To be your loving and faithful husband.
To be your loving and faithful husband.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In plenty and in want.
In plenty and in want.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
This ring I give you.
This ring I give you.
As a symbol and pledge.
As a symbol and pledge.
Of constant faith.
As constant faith.
And abiding love.
And abiding love.
Are you ready? I, Sydney.
I, Sydney.
Take you, Johnny.
Take you, Johnny.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
And I do promise.
And I do promise.
In covenant before God.
In covenant before God.
And these witnesses.
And these witnesses.
To be your loving and faithful wife.
To be your loving and faithful wife.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In plenty and in want.
In plenty and in want.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
This ring I give you.
This ring I give you.
As a symbol and pledge.
As a symbol and pledge.
Of constant faith.
Of constant faith.
And abiding love.
And abiding love.
All right, my son. Friends and family, join with me as we pray for this couple one more time. Father, we thank you for what a beautiful commitment that they have made to one another. Father, we pray that these words will not only bind them together in their commitment, but may these words be bounded together to one another because of their commitment to Christ first and foremost. Be with them, watch over them, Lord, bless them. Surround them with people that will come to walk with them, speak into their lives, so they'll continue to walk and picture who you want them to be. We thank you for this moment. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Could hold hands. By the virtue of the authority committed unto me by the Church of Christ and the law of the state, I now pronounce you husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As a symbol of physical and emotional, spiritual union before God and these witnesses. Johnny, you may now, as long as you wish, kiss the bride. Let's pray one last time and thank God for this union. Father, thank you so much for this beautiful union. Thank you for the kiss that symbolizes that they are now committed. We thank you that this is a church that you have planted. And through this union, through their marriage, may you be glorified and honored. And Lord, as we witness together as friends and family, Lord, bless them and watch over them and walk with them. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God that surrounds Johnny and Sydney and all of us that are gathered here, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Turn. Turn and face the audience, actually. I'm going to help move the... You guys ready? All right. Ladies and gentlemen, for the very first time, let me introduce you to Mr. and Mrs. Johnny and Sydney Simmons. No, we improv.